Hi, my name is Jim Arabito, and I'm a Seventh-day Adventist layman. As a Seventh-day Adventist, I'm very, very interested in the fulfillment of prophecies in these last days. Especially am I aware of the place of Roman Catholicism in closing events. Well, I was on a street ministry in Berkeley about 10 years ago. I became acquainted with a Roman Catholic Jesuit priest from the University of San Francisco. I asked him in one of our conversations, "Have you read The Great Controversy?" And he explained to me that The Great Controversy has a lot of truth in it. In fact, he told me that the Roman Catholic Church will rule the world again. For a while, I was in a state of shock. You know, it just happens to be that although we're Seventh-day Adventists, many times we don't see in reality the very things that we supposedly believe. It hit me very hard, and I began about 10 years ago collecting books on Roman Catholicism and world politics. You know, we as Adventists expect somehow to see all these events take place out in the open. But you know, I found that that is not what Revelation 17 tells us. Revelation 17, verse 3 says this, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast." Well, a scarlet-colored beast is all the political powers that are going to pull together to destroy the commandments of God. The woman riding on that beast is Roman Catholicism and fundamental Christianity. John describes these things as taking place in the wilderness. Now, in reading Revelation chapter 12, we know that when the primitive church fled persecution, she went into the wilderness. And in Great Controversy, page 55, Ellen White tells us that the wilderness is a symbol that represents obscurity and seclusion. This means that at the end of time, Roman Catholicism is working in secret with the rulers of this world in an effort to control the world, to take it over. And I believe that time is right upon us. You know, I plan to put together a documentary film called The Missing Dimensions in World Affairs. And for that film, I had gathered together interviews with people who had had either personal experiences with infiltration of Jesuits or Catholic priests, or in one instance, an interview with an ex-Jesuit priest by the name of Alberto Rivera, and another, a secret agent for the federal government working for the Pentagon during the Second World War, and his wife was a chief stenographer of the Pentagon. All the funds that went over to Europe for the troops passed first through the Vatican. This man had had personal working relationships with Roman Catholic priests, and listen to him, he knows what he's talking about. I had to stop my plans to do this documentary and decide to just get these things before you right now. The Jesuit priests have been infiltrating every institution, and they're ready now for a takeover. I want you to pay close attention to this first person that we're going to interview. He's an ex-Jesuit priest, and he tells you about the infiltration by the Jesuits.
Especially I work in dealing with the infiltration of churches and religious institutions as well as government. That cover a tremendous number of institutions.
And the purpose of that infiltration was what for?
Well, the purpose is what the Roman Catholic system has all the time as her own purpose, is to infiltrate, to penetrate all the areas of life where the Roman Catholic can have control and access for the coming world government. What that means is, in preparation for that world government, the Roman Catholic institution, especially since the establishment of the Jesuit order in 1541, throughout all these 500 years, they've been in preparation, in and through infiltration and penetration of every level of society in order to take over the world politically and religiously. There are two doctrines that define very well these dangerous goals of the Roman Catholic institution. Two doctrines define this very well. One is called the doctrine of the apostolic succession, and that is dealing with the papacy. And the other is the doctrine, the temporal power, and that is dealing with world government. Of course, both, because you can see that even the Pope and his own individual office, he meet those requirements. He is not only the head of his church, as he called himself, John Paul II, the present Pope, he said he is the pastor of his church. He is not only that, but he is the head of his state, of his country. What that means, he is the head of a political state. Both combinations are in one office there. And prophetically speaking, that is what we see in the Book of Revelation. The political power always hand to hand with the religious power.
I was in Chicago years ago, and I was canvassing as a cow porter selling Bible readings for Home Circle. And we come to one great big mansion where the folks were rich in that area, and cars all around it and so forth. But I went up the door, and I was pretty sure this fellow was a Catholic, so I gave him the Catholic canvas. And he invited me in, and then as soon as he got in, he turned the key and the door, and I said, wait a minute, what am I getting into? He opened another door into a great big mammoth parlor and a great big mammoth dining room with double doors in between, and all seated around the whole business was prelates, some from Europe and all the big ones from America. They were planning the Eucharistic Congress in Chicago. That was way back in the 1920s. And when they started talking to me, they tried to get me to be one of them and offered me every kind of a conceivable opportunity that you could think of. They offered me everything, money, scholarship, and the whole works, and told me the advantage of being Catholic and what they were planning on doing in America and with America. They said, we're going to take over America, and we've already got it fixed, so no, how in the world can they escape becoming under our authority, and where we'll be in the jurisdiction and take over. I said, well, how are you going to take over the South? It's predominantly Protestant. It says we're going to seed the South with Catholic families. And then when they marry into the Protestants, their children will be raised Catholic, and before long we'll have a quarter, and then we'll have a third, then we'll have over half, and when we get over half, we've got America. That's one way of doing it. But it says that we've got other ways too. Well, I says, supposing all this was known, and the people, Protestants, knew this, he said, if they knew what we were planning on doing, there'd be bloodshed in 24 hours and lots of them in 48. I said, are you prepared to take over in case that happens? He said, yes, we have our standing armies. We have everything all prepared with guns, ammunition, and the whole works. And said, we can take over, and you might as well join us and be in with us and get in on the right side of the fence. I said to him, I said, listen, there is nothing you can do to inveigle me to become a Catholic. I mean nothing. I says, I know my horse is going through to eternity, and I'm riding on it. And I know your horses aren't, and I know that you'll be nonplus entities when I'll be enjoying eternity and having a good time forever. And I'm going to see to it that I'm on the right side of the fence. And I know which side I'm on now. And I said, you might as well open the door and let me out, because I know that other people know that I'm in here, and there'll be investigation made if you don't let me out. One of the big fellows with a red cardinal hat got up and said, sir, he said, we're going to let you out. But we want you to know one thing, that everybody that's born in the United States that's not born a Catholic is on a card. You're put on a white card to begin with and kept on a white card until we feel like that we need to watch you. After that, we put you on a blue card and said, after you're on a blue card for a while, if we feel like that we just assume you wasn't existing, you're on a red card. Son, from now on, you'll be on a red card as long as you live. And I know they know me where I'm living and have followed me all around throughout life. They're still doing it. And, well, I could tell you a lot of stories, but that's just one.
Yes, it was in 1967 when a friend of mine came to me very excitedly. He told me that he was doing some call porter work in Indiana. And while knocking on different doors to gain entrance, he was invited into a home very quickly. And he wondered how come he didn't have to use his door openers. When he went in, the fellow who had invited him into his home said, I know who you people are. And he said, well, what do you mean? He says, well, let me show you something here. And he moved aside a rug from his flooring there, and under that rug was a door. He lifted up the door, and here were stairs that went down into a basement. And he said, I would like to show you something. So they went down into the basement, and this individual whose home he was in showed him just many files. And as he was looking at these files, he wondered what it meant. He says, well, he says, we know who you are, and I would like to ask you a question. Name me a name of somebody who belongs to your church. And so he said, okay. He named him a name, one of his girlfriends. And this man went to a file, picked out that name, and said, this person was baptized on such and such a date, a member of such and such a church, etc. And my friends said his eyes got very large, and he says, well, what does this mean? How come you have this information here? And this fellow said, well, I belong to the Catholic Church. I belong to a special order. And we have all of you on files in different parts of the country. This is the file that we have on your members of your church here. We know who you are, and we have more complete records on you than I believe you people have for yourself. He said, I just wanted you to see that so you would know that we know who you are. Well, my friend left that home. He didn't sell any books, but I think he became a more serious thinking individual after that.
Because I was always able to open up to anybody that I cared anything about, even a friend, much less your husband. And he was this way all the time I was married to him. Very evasive.
Was he gone for long periods?
Yes, he was. He was gone for 3 and 4 months, sometimes out of the year, sometimes a less amount of time, but always no less than 6 weeks at a time. And he would act so bitter when he left. He'd get me all upset to where I'd tell him, why don't you leave, Joe? And so he'd act so sad, but he'd leave. And I saw later that he really intended it to be this way.
He was manipulating you.
Right, that's true.
Mm-hmm. Did he show any remorse?
Not really. No, it was just as though that was his line of work. Very dear neighbors that lived across the street from me. And they knew my husband, and they had known us for years. And so when Joe and I were married, and he would try to communicate with them, but I don't know if he was revealing anything to them that he wasn't saying to me. But these folks told me, they were first to tell me that Joe, in fact, was a priest. Many of my friends questioned Joe in their own minds, not to his face, but they thought he was a very strange person. They thought it was strange that he'd have so many absences from our marriage. But of course, I took all the blame for that, not fully realizing that he was irritating me to the point of sending him away these times when it was necessary, in fact, that he was away. Because his church, I'm sure he had the calling that he had to answer, or the work that he had to do for his church.
At what point were you sure that you had married somebody pretty high up in the Roman Catholic Church?
When he had finally convinced me that it'd be wise for us to marry in his church. And I had belonged to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, or I guess I hadn't yet been baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but I felt that it probably would be smart to marry him in the Catholic Church. And so I went ahead, and then we went over to see a priest in Reno and was going to discuss being married. We had to go over to another office, another group of offices, and see a cardinal. And so when we went to discuss our marriage with the cardinal, Joe was rather talking down to the cardinal, and I felt this was sort of unusual, because realizing just common knowledge that people didn't talk down to a cardinal if they were Catholics, and I thought that to be a bit strange. And the cardinal took Joe, now the two of them walked away, supposedly out of range of my hearing, and that's when I realized that he in fact was a Catholic priest. And he had told me that he was going to, what was that word I wanted to use?
Excommunicate.
He wanted to excommunicate himself. And I thought, this is strange, a man that devoted to church wants to excommunicate himself. And then when I heard the discussion about the priesthood, I threw up the papers and I said, I've had it. I'm going to quit. This is it. I'm not going to be married.
When you heard what discussion about the priesthood?
Well, I could hear little bits about your position and this position and that position. It was just very scanty, but I knew that it was at this time discussing his priesthood.
How long had you been actually married to him at this time? About?
Oh, 6 years, I guess. I threw the papers up, yes. What I have here, I gathered up. I noticed that even my divorce papers are gone, but I don't know what's happened to those, but you did see the papers, the wedding certificate that I have, and I don't know what happened to the divorce certificate.
Did you take any pictures of Joe?
Well, there were lots of pictures made, yes. We had many made.
And then what happened to them?
They were taken. I don't know where they went, but I don't have any pictures left of him at all now.
Did he take them?
I don't believe so. I don't believe so, but who knows?
But you don't have any pictures of Joe today?
No, none whatsoever.
You'd mentioned that someone had broken into your house and stolen?
Yeah, some of the things were taken from me, stolen from me, yes.
Who would want pictures?
There must have been something else packed in that box. I'm sure there was. Or, who knows? It's a crazy thing. There were quite a few things missing. Even personal pictures of my children, my grandchildren.
Now, he made a boast one day about Hitler. What exactly did he say about Hitler?
He said Hitler was one of our very good people. Hitler and Mussolini, he said, you know, were good Catholics. And he said, also the Mafia. He said, we have some good people in our church. When I showed him the book that I had gotten, written by Samuel Bacciocchi, he said, that's one of our men. And so he said, notice where it was published. And he turned right away to the area in the front of the book where it tells you published in Rome. And he pointed that out very carefully to me.
Are you telling me that in the same breath that he mentioned Hitler and Mussolini, that he mentioned Samuel Bacciocchi?
I'm not sure of that. I'm really not sure of that. I don't know that that was at the same time.
How did you feel when he said that? Did you think he was kidding you?
Yeah. I thought he was jesting a lot of the times. And I would question him about it. And he really wasn't jesting at all, but you had the feeling that he was. Joe was a very sober person, and it was difficult to know when he was joking, which was seldom. He was very serious. He had a serious mission within him that he carried out.
I was reared in Pasadena, in Southern California, which is only a few miles from Glendale, where Merle Vance used to speak on Sabbath afternoons in his discussions of the Catholic Church with the number 666 and how paganism had worked into the church. It was intensely interesting. Even I've used some of the things he has said even yet today. But he had these mimeograph sheets that he used to pass out that had the pictures that he had copied from his various publications. I know he did a lot of study when he went back to the seminary. He was studying on the connection between 666 and the Roman Church. And when he went to the seminary, some of the people there said, well, now we think we know that there's a Jesuit on the staff here. And we think we know who it is. Merle hadn't been there very long until he said, I think I knew who it was too. Well, he continued his study, and he had pictures from the books that were printed in Rome by the church. And this is what was on these mimeograph sheets that he used to pass out. But at the height of his study, he took some of this amazing material which he had and took it to one of the leaders there in Washington and showed him what they had. This man, without even looking at the paper that Merle had, said, Brother Vance, that study is not for you. But he said, look what I've got. It's all here. It's proved. Here's the pictures. Here's the proof of it. There's no question. He said, Brother Vance, that material and that subject is not for you. Well, he was pretty downhearted. He went to his major professor, which was a professor of history, and he showed him what he had. This professor said, we want you to write your term paper on that. Well, he said, I'm sorry, but I've already talked with this leader, and he gave his name, and he says that I must not study this any further, so I don't dare write a term paper on it. Well, time went on, and some of his friends said if he didn't change his topic, he would never graduate. In fact, a major professor said that. So he did change his topic to something inconsequential. Finally, the time came for Merle's graduation from the seminary. And it just happened that this leader had been called to Europe for a year, and it was during that year that Merle was graduated. So he had his papers. Following that, this leader died. And a very close friend of this leader was talking with Merle one day, and he said, I know positively that that leader, that that man was a Jesuit, because I was a very close friend of him, and I know this positively. Merle was certainly a good student. I remember him when I heard a tape of him recently. I recognized his voice. It was so thrilling to hear his voice again, because I enjoyed those messages which he gave. He was a good student, a fine man, a real scholar. Certainly he was a credit to this people.
The subject of Jesuit infiltration into Protestant churches, whenever that subject is brought up, it's often ignored, dismissed, or just brushed aside. For some reason, they don't like to think of this fact. But the story I'm about to tell you occurred in 1939. At a Seventh-day Adventist institution, Washington Missionary College, located in Tacoma Park, Maryland. This was told to me by Dr. B.G. Wilkinson, who was president of the college from 1935 to 1945. Now, Dr. Wilkinson told me that he uncovered a Jesuit infiltrator at that time, 1939. And this is how it happened. There had been a new Bible instructor hired by the board, and this man had been teaching Bible to the undergraduate theological majors for about 5 months. Now, Dr. Wilkinson had always encouraged an open-door policy, and he encouraged the confidences of his students, especially his theological students. Now, some of these young men came to him after a period of about 4 or 5 months. And they said, Dr. Wilkinson, you teach Bible differently than this new Bible instructor does. There's some things about him that we don't understand. He brings up doubts in the classroom, doubts about our theological position, about our doctrines. These doubts are then not resolved. They're left sort of hanging in the air. And they had other questions, which Dr. Wilkinson couldn't answer. It aroused Dr. Wilkinson's suspicions about this man. Now, the teachers had in Old Columbia Hall little pigeonholes, boxes where their mail slots, you know, they used to put their mail in these little pigeonholes, and the faculty would come and pick up their letters. This one day, Wilkinson saw an envelope being placed by the mailman in the mail slot for this Bible teacher. And the letter was a rather long, rectangular, official-looking letter. And after the mailman left, Dr. Wilkinson stepped over to the box and he drew the letter out. And he looked at it, and the return address was a Hereford Road address. Now, Wilkinson knew that that was a Jesuit college. It wasn't located too far from Washington Missionary College. He took the letter and he steamed it open. Of course, this was an illegal act. But, you know, when you're dealing with a class like they are, they committed many illegal acts in their time, the assassination of princes being the least of their illegal acts. And you know, the Jesuit motto is the end justifies the means. And Wilkinson thought, I'm going to steam this letter open. And if it's an innocent thing, I'll just close it up again, say nothing. Steam it open, and inside he found orders from this young man's superior, telling the young man, outlining to him what he was to preach or teach in his Bible class for the next several months. Dr. Wilkinson reinserted the letter, gummed the flap back on. He called the young teacher in. He said to this young man, he had the letter on his desk, and he said to this young man, I have a piece of mail for you. And he handed it to him. And he says, we know who you are, and we know why you are here. You are a Jesuit, are you not? The young man looked across the desk at Dr. Wilkinson. He picked up his mail, turned on his heel, and walked out. And it was the last they ever saw of this man. He never even stopped to pick up his pay. But he cleared off of that campus the very same hour.
When I was in detective work in Washington, D.C. during World War II, I was going home to Alexandria, Virginia, from Washington, D.C., and when I got to the mall, there was two scholars, and they were sticking up their fingers for a ride. I said, I'll just pick them up and put them in the back seat and see what I can find out from them. And so when they got in the back seat and was seated, I asked them, I said, you boys are from Georgetown University taking the priesthood, aren't you? No. We're not taking the priesthood, they said. Well, I said, you're scholars from Georgetown University taking something. What are you taking? They said, we're Anglican brothers. Well, I said, the church has never told us what Anglican brothers are, nor much about them, and I don't know much about them. What do Anglican brothers do, and what are they for? They said, well, we're taking studies to work with the Protestant churches and get them to come in to do what the church wants them to do and to work with them and work with us. And I said, well, how many of you folks are taking the course? They said, well, about 780. And I said, how many have graduated? Oh, somewhere between 780 and 800. 780. I said, how many graduated last year? And they told me. And then I said, the year before that. And they told me. And I went back till we had About 3,800 people graduated and out in the field. And I said, well, what do you boys do when you go out in the field? No, I said, first I want to know how many graduate next year. Well, it says it'll be somewhere under 900 anyway. And I said, how about, what do you do when you graduate? He said, well, the first thing, we change our names. And when we change our names, then we're allocated so many to this church, so many to that church, and to another church. And I said, when you go out to the churches, then what do you do? He said, well, first thing we do is look around for some nice young lady that we'd like to make an associate member with, and then we marry them. And after we're married, we go off to a Protestant theological seminary or school, and we come out a Protestant minister. Then we're taught to, in our course, to work up to the heads as fast as we can in that line, where we're supposed to work in. And I said, now, do all of you work in the same field? No, says some of us work, but we all work in the church trying to get the churches to unite with us and do what they want us, we want them to do.
So were these Roman Catholic students then?
They were, as far as I learned, from what I learned, they were Jesuits. I know they don't only infiltrate the Protestant churches, but they infiltrate their schools. And I know one fellow that got to be teacher in the Methodist school, and as a result of that, a lot of the Methodist ministers today are carrying communist cards. They utilize anything and everybody to bring their means to an end.
My story goes back a few years ago. My father first got the ministry, Pastor Arabido. He was sent by the General Conference to Reno, Nevada, which was his first ministry among the Italian-speaking people. At that time, there were quite a few that had migrated from the east to the west, and especially in the Reno area. So a call went out for a young minister, and my dad was ready and willing and consecrated to do his part in the ministry. He was a young minister at that time. And he was sent to Reno, Nevada. And from there, he was sent to, a call came through not long after that, after there was 40 to 50 members, a call came through to go to San Francisco. And of course, a minister has to always be willing to whether he wanted to or not, to go where he was called. And the call came through, and he did. He went to San Francisco to open up the work there among the Italian-speaking people. Of course, at that time, we never had any thought of who the Jesuits were and what they were about to do and what they were doing, even at that time, and that was some time ago. Anyway, after he was there a while, he got a call to go to Oakland to work among the Italian-speaking people. And he was told that he would be working side by side with a man by the name of Calderoni, Elder Rosario Calderoni, who would be in charge of the Italian work in that area. So my dad went and took orders from Elder Calderoni. He worked in Oakland and El Cerrito and Richmond for a while, bringing people to church and working with them, giving Bible studies, and many souls were baptized at that time due to the work which promoted that area. At that time, he became friendly with Elder Calderoni, and in one instance, Elder Calderoni admitted that he was raised and sent to school, to the Roman Catholic school back in Italy, and he was going to be a Jesuit. He was an admitted Jesuit at that time. And he said that he broke away from the Jesuits and became an Adventist because he saw that they didn't have the truth. Well, naturally we all believed him. But it wasn't long after that when Dad would answer a call to the Stockton area to raise a little church in the Stockton area, which he went. And of course, all this time, he was under the direction of Elder Rosario Calderoni. And that's when we realized that there was something wrong. Elder Calderoni, at that time, we didn't know it, but was gradually destroying the work that was being done among the Italian-speaking people. The people would come in and complain and that money was being sent to Calderoni and wondered where was what it was happening to it. And all the while, why he was visiting people and speaking against the ones, the young people, including my dad, that had newly come into truth at that time. Many of the young Italian ministers at that time were being dropped, one by one, for one excuse or another. And we found out it was Calderoni speaking to Elder Hauswick, who at that time was in charge of the foreign work. And we were wondering why this was happening. The church was being undermined. We just don't know how it was happening until later, of course, we realized that we felt that it was because of the background, and possibly Elder Calderoni was still in the work the Jesuits pay or under their direction. It had to be, because otherwise the work would have gone ahead, because it went ahead so beautifully before that. Friends, I can only tell you of one incident, but of course I hear of many others. And if one person can get into our work and cause a destruction among the Italian-speaking people, I shudder to think of how many more are doing the same thing today.
That was my father, John Arbido, who was kept from the ministry by Jesuit influences in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Adventists should wake up. Time is short. What organizations have now been taken over by the Jesuit order and other institutes of Catholicism? What world powers are in her hands to be used in this final chess game for the takeover of the world? We can get some idea when we look back to the Council of Trent in the 1540s through the 1560s. At that time, during those years, we find vows that were taken by these secret orders to take over the education of the Protestants, take over their schools, take over their churches, especially to destroy the Protestant Bible by creating many translations, destroy the monarchies of Europe, destroy nationalism, to use astronomy and astrology to create new calendars that would eventually transfer the sanctity from Sabbath or Saturday to Sunday. Their goal was to take over the business world, internationalism. They were to take over banking, to take over Judaism and the movement of Zionism, to create political strife and chaos and all of these things for one end, that Catholicism should rule. Listen.
I did training in monasteries and convent where I prepare Crucigistas, the Legion of Mary, the Blue Army, many of these militant organizations. I train and prepare how they can become Baptists, how they can become Adventists, how they can become Methodists, how they can become Presbyterian, how they can become Pentecostal, and all these areas where they most infiltrate any area.
You bring up one of the other questions I have, might as well ask it now, particularly the Blue Army. Is that in some way connected with the Fatima?
That's correct.
Is
yes.
that to protect it, or
that they are the army that creates the greatest promotion of that cult, yes, of that satanic cult here in United States. In every country, the Roman Catholicism display this promotion to the so-called Virgin, that is not even Mary, the Mary that we know in the Gospel, but a distortion of that really truly Mary of the Gospel. They display to different militant organizations, the promotional need for certain saying or vision, whatever. And the Blue Army is the greatest promoter of the call to marry here in the United States. The Opus Dei is another arm of the Jesuits. But that means you have Masons, you have Illuminatis, you have the New Age movement, you have the Trilateral Commission, you have the Club of Rome, you have so many others. There are in different areas working through certain programs what they need in that particular area where these organizations move, these, where there are secret or public organizations. They need to control certain area of certain people, and this is where and how they'll be ready to have them under control through these organizations. The Opus Dei mainly, they move next to what they call Christian democracy. The so-called Christian democracy is an outgrowth of this Opus Dei. It's exactly the words in Latin precisely define that. The Latin definition is, for Opus Dei, is the work of God. what that means, the Opus Dei, Opus meaning the work, and then you have, how you call them, Dei, Opus Dei, the work of God.
When the Council of Trent occurred, it was controlled by the Jesuits.
Yes.
How about the Vatican II?
Now,
there a connection there?
Yes, the connection is very, very, very prophetical. I will say this, I think that will clear the whole point here. Because it's so prophetical that while the Council of Trent was the first council to be managed by the Jesuit order, the Vatican Council was brought about by the same Jesuit order with the same intention. And you know the intention of the Council of Trent. The intention behind the Council of Trent was the Counter-Reformation. What was the intent of the Vatican Council II? Another Counter-Reformation, but called today, how you call it? Renewal. You see the point? Now, the change was a name, but the intentions were the same.
Yes.
See, more sophisticated today.
Yes.
You see, the Counter-Reformation was taken through the to the Council of Trent. That was, the entire Counter-Reformation was performed by the Council of Trent, decrees. Then through that time, until today, Vatican Council II came about with the idea of renewal. That means another step forward, and the final, I will say this is the final stage of a Counter-Reformation.
Now, how about the charismatic movement? What's the connection with that?
The charismatic movement is serving the purpose, as we said, of one of the many issues. As we said about Saturdays and Sunday, they'll pick up every issue with different denominations. And in the case of the charismatic movement, they pick up the charismatic movement because one factor. They could not bring under subjection the Pentecostal denominations.
They couldn't.
They could not. Even when they went through the ecumenical movement before, from 1945 down to our day, since this already started. As a matter of fact, if you want to know, the World Council of Churches started by financed by the Jesuits in Europe in 1945 after the end of the Second World War already, or by the time that the World War was to end, already the Jesuits were at work trying to unite all the Protestants in Europe. And that was the origin of the World Council of Churches and the Ecumenical Movement. Today, the Charismatic Movement is serving that purpose. Where the Pentecostal could not be bring into the Ecumenical Forum, they brought it through the exercise of charismatic gift.
We were on the way back from London on a jet plane, and there was a man dressed in a uniform like the Catholic priests wear, and he was conducting himself not like a priest you'd see in a movie, very friendly. He was a very sophisticated type man. And people could sense that. And I never thought I'd see him again. But in Baltimore, at the airline station, where the baggage has come off, well, I turned around and there he was next to me. And I just turned to him and said, "Hello, friend. Are you a Jesuit?" And he says, yes, with a big smile. You see all of his teeth. And he was very happy with himself. I said, well, listen, I'm very interested in the Jesuits. I've read some about them. And what would you think about the Council of Trent and what was invented in the Council of Trent and the infiltration of the Jesuits into Protestantism and the use of the Jesuits through organizations like the Illuminati and the futurism theory, the secret rapture that they invented for the Protestants. And I talked about a lot of those things, and he had a metamorphosis take place. His face became rigid, his smile went away, and he looked me right in the eyes and he said, you know quite a bit, don't you? Like he never expected it. And I told him that I was one of the Protestants that got away. And if he could realize that, if somebody like me knew those things, just imagine some of the other of God's people that know those things and are willing to tell anybody about them. And it was an amazing situation how that man's face changed. And he thought he was like in one identity, but all of a sudden he realized that these dark secrets of theirs, they're being found out. And I'll never forget that.
Would you consider that Jesuitism to be an occult secret society?
It is. It is an occult secret society from the point of view that the Jesuit order, what you know of the Jesuit order and what everybody knows of the Jesuit order, is not the true Jesuit order. What that means is even the Jesuits within the Jesuit order, they all are not knowing the secret society, the inner secret society that they are surrounded by.
Spiritualism and the papacy is as close as two fingers are on your hand.
One cult that started from Fatima, okay, the cult of Fatima, Roman Catholic cult, seems to be antagonistic to the rest of the Roman Catholic Church. Seems that they believe that the Pope that's in now is an antichrist.
The whole thing is that Satan gets as many people as he can on his side, and by starting something else up, he can get more.
Oh, I see.
And he starts first one thing and then another. That's why he's got so many churches and so many cults and so many this and so many that. What he can't get one person on, he gets them on another. Mm-hmm. And the biggest thing that he gets most people on is TV. Satan has all kinds of organizations. Mm-hmm. But the Catholic Church is his one biggest, most extensive organization that there is in the world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He has these others organized to take care of things, but and in some places he works, even destroys himself to make other things work out for himself.
What's the connection between Jesuitism and communism?
Well, that's a long story, but really, communism was really started by the Catholic Church, and the Pope himself is allied with them and a communist himself. They sent some Jesuits into a little town where they wanted to start Catholicism. Now this I learned from E.T. Babienko that worked with me on a lot of detective work that I did. And E.T. Babienko told me that after they had no success for a short while, they substituted the place with twice as many Jesuits as they had in the beginning, and after years they got nowhere. So they said the only way in the big meetings in the Vatican, where the headmen all meet, they said the only way we'll ever get anywhere in putting Catholicism in Russia is to take away the children from the parents and do away with the Greek Orthodox Church by training the children otherwise. And in their brains, this was all formulated, and they decided to put communism into Russia and to put hard-boiled communism, which is Bolshevism, and later bring it on to a de-Christianized Christian Bolshevism.
So the connection between Zionistic Judaism and communism then is, would you say that's a fraudulent story?
Yes, to some extent, and yet they use the Jews wherever they can.
So the Roman Catholic Church utilizes Judaism.
They utilize anything and everybody to bring their means to an end.
So these writers that point to the international Jewish conspiracy, drawing from historical material that appears to see the Jewish involvement in all this, may very well be part of the Catholic ploy to take the heat off of themselves?
Yes, and that's absolutely the truth. And have you ever heard tell of this book that the Zion had taken over?
Protocols. Chief Elders of Zion.
Yes. I have one of the books. They're hard to get. I can get them if necessary for anybody. But I have ways and means of getting them, but it takes me a little while to get them. And when you get them, you better keep them to yourself. But here's the thing. When the Zionists got all that underneath, the Catholics got a hold of some of this material in these books. And now, what do you think that Hitler did away with all the Jews for, is to get rid of the heads and the ones that would promote the Zionism. And they're doing what the Zionists propose to do.
So they actually, in reality then, there is a Zionist movement, but the Roman Church is trying to take over it and control it.
Yeah,
for their own purposes.
They have a club of 300 at Rome that does nothing but figure out how they can do it and why they can do it and where they can do it and why they can go ahead. The war in Vietnam was nothing more than just using the United States to put in Catholicism into Vietnam.
What do you know about the organization of the Knights of Columbus?
I know too much.
Too much.
And too much to tell.
Oh, I see.
But I know one thing. That is that they're a strong organization in the United States, and they have a lot to do with this here Ustasha army.
The Ustaches?
Yes.
Are the Knights of Columbus also organized in other countries?
You bet your life they are.
Or were they financing the Ustaches of certain?
Wherever they're is in other countries, they're organized. Wherever the Catholics are in force, they're organized.
Well, is the Knights of Columbus an extension of the Jesuit order?
Well,
but into secular
they
society?
They all work and with together. They're dovetailed.
Do you know anything about the connection between Roman Catholicism and Masonry?
They're tied in together.
Would you say Roman Catholicism actually manipulates and controls Masonry?
They've got to the place where they're in control of a lot of things, and they have a lot to do with Masonry. You know, one of the heads of Masonry, at the head of things, is a Catholic.
One night he told you that they run our church. Tell us about that.
His people run our church, he said.
Who were his people?
The Catholic Church. The Catholic Church run all churches.
He said that to you?
Yes, yes.
And specifically that the Catholic Church runs the Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Well, very much like that. I don't recall exactly the way it was worded. This is the impression that I got from what he had said, the statement that he had made. We. He always said, whenever he said we, that was the church and he. He always included himself as the church.
From Jeannie's testimony about her marriage to a Catholic priest agent, we get a sense of the tremendous confidence that the Roman Catholic Church has now in her position of dominating the nations and its institutions. Very soon, we're going to be locked into a period of terrible persecution, and there'll be many martyrs among the faithful Christians. Listen to the words of Revelation 17, verse 6. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. She is uniting with the rulers of the world. Listen in verse 12. And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Rulers in this world will give their political power to a system, a political system, that will be dominated by the papacy. And that system is going to make war upon God and his followers. In Revelation 18, part of our last message to the world is to tell the world, all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornications, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, that the governments of the world are in an unholy alliance with the Roman papacy, and God is going to judge them. I want you to listen very carefully to Dr. Hiram Duke's testimony as he shares their position in world politics.
When I was behind these locked doors, they told me that they were going to cede the South. And with what they told me then, I knew they were planning World War II. And I knew they were planning on bringing all the DPs and ceding the South with DPs. They've done it. They've got to the place now where...
DP is... What's a DP?
That's the folks that are displaced in the old country on account of war.
Well, one thing that's interesting is no bombs are dropped on the Vatican.
Well, my wife was the head stenographer in the Vatican, I mean in the Pentagon at that time. Mm-hmm. And she gave all the orders and sent out all the orders to the big men. And she had orders to see that there was no Protestant flew over the Vatican and over Rome because they were afraid that they might, through their own ingenuity, want to drop a bomb there. Are you aware that the head immigration authority in Germany was a strong Catholic and that he let the men in that were trained in New York for the hooligans that went over to do away with the Tsar and his outfit, and they were shipped by him into Moscow by getting one of their men into Moscow and shipped in boxcars, and this fellow in Moscow that got in there ahead went and opened the padlocks off a boxcar and let them out, and they went right up and did away with
them. Lenin and Trotsky.
Yes, sir.
Trotsky was trained in New York, wasn't he?
Yeah.
The head of a bunch of hoodlums.
Got to talking with E.T. Babienko about a lot of things. And we got in places where we wanted to know things. And we put on priest garb, dressed up like a priest, and he put on even garbs on beyond the priesthood. Well, because he spoke in 44 languages more fluent than I do in English, and his wife speaks 33 languages fluent. Why, and he understands enough in other languages right away quick, and he picks them up like magic. The General Conference used him for interpreter to go between a lot of these places wherever they needed him. And he went to Europe and went to Asia and a lot of these different things. And when he went to Asia, he was over in the Himalaya Mountains, where it's so difficult to learn the language. He learned some things was going on in Europe, and he wanted to go over and find it out. So he took an airplane, and he flew over there, and he dressed up like a big head man in the Catholic Church, and he went in with among these other men, and he purported that he couldn't understand their language. They had to get him an interpreter. So they got him an interpreter, and he understood their language better than they did. And he understood everything they were saying and everything they were saying about him. And that way, why, he fooled them to where they thought he was a high dignitary, and he went in and found out things that he wouldn't otherwise. When he found out when he went to Europe that they were planning on getting rid of the Greek Orthodox Catholic Church. And one reason they tried with the the Illuminati tried to put a bank in Russia, and they couldn't get the bank in Russia because the fact that the Tsar was too smart for them. And so they said, well, the only thing we can do is do away with the Tsar. And
what years was this?
Well, this was way back in the time of before the World War I. They wanted to get, not only get rid of the Tsar, but they wanted to get Catholicism into Russia. And they were trying this before they tried to get the money bank in there. And when they sent, I think it was 1,000 Jesuits into Russia, most of them are centered around a little country town and a little place in Russia. And they tried it for over a year and they didn't make any headway. So they sent twice as many more in that area, and then they didn't get anywhere, and so they called a big meeting over in Rome of all the head folks from all over the world, and they planned on what they could do, and they found out that the best thing they could do was to get rid of the parents taking care of their children, to educate the children, and that way, if they took the children away from the parents, that they could control and get Catholicism in there later. So they put in hard-shelled Bolshevik communism, and they said, well, we'll annul that and get a choice in that way later on, and put in a de-Christianized Christian communism. And they planned all this ahead. And he learned this. When he got this information, and they found out that they'd done this already, and that they'd take the children away so that they could imbibe communism into the children and take them away from, do away with the Greek Orthodox Catholic Church. And then they could control and later get things into Russia, and control Russia. And they'd do away with the Tsar and the government and the whole works. And then they planned on doing it in World War I. They dined, wined, and educated 300 hooligans in New York to do all this and to go over and take over the Tsar and take over Russia and put this Bolshevism in Russia. Well, when they got it all ready, they had already gotten their man. The first president that they really put in was Woodrow Wilson. And they had gotten him in office, and so they told Woodrow Wilson, you tell England if she don't let those men in the ship that you've captured go on into France and things go on through, that we won't bring the United States in and won't do anything for you, and you'll be out of luck. And so immediately they let the ship go on into France and went into Switzerland, down into the dark forest, and the head man of migration was Catholic, and he loaded one of them on the train and got him into Moscow through one crook or another. And then when he got him into Moscow, he loaded the rest of the 300 with all their guns, ammunition, and money, $20 million in gold, in boxcars, and sent them in there. When they got there, this fellow that was in Moscow opened up the boxcars that they were sent to him, and out they come and went right straight up and took the Tsar over, and they were scared for a long time that they weren't going to make the grade, but they did. And communism was in Russia. Now, after they got that all done, then this fellow decided, there's something going on, and I'd like to know a little more about some of these things. So a little later, he went over to a new part of the Balkan states and went in dressed up the same as he did before. And he found out that they'd called the folks from all over the world into the Vatican to plan for things in the future, and that they were planning on putting a new war into Second World War, and that they planned and put Hitler in to do it. And he found out the reason it was all done and why they had it when they did have was that the young folks in Germany were falling for Bolshevism and communism, and the young folks in the Catholic Church in Italy were doing the same. And they said, well, we've got to put something in there that's as near like it that they'll fall for and control the situation. And so they finally, after considering a lot of things and so forth, they said, we've got to do something, because something got to be done. They put out a magazine among these young folks to stop them from turning Bolshevik and communist oriented, and it was so bad that they decided that they'd have to do something, because Russia put out another magazine that told it way back before this they had controlled another country with the same kind of government, and it was in such and such books and such libraries in Europe, and they printed what was in the books and in these magazines. It had such a percussion that they said, we've got to do something else, we've got to control the situation. So they said, we'll put in Nazism in Russia that was born in their brains, and fascism in Italy, and we'll pick our men, and they had Hitler picked and his face altered to do the job. They sent
what
money.
What do you mean by his face altered?
Well, they altered his nose and different things.
Oh, really?
And then they picked Mussolini for Italy, and they sent hundreds of thousands of dollars to begin the situation, and it went through the Swiss banks into Germany. I know of that from what about E.T. Babienka told me. And when they got the whole thing started, it was all planned, fascism, and that's how Hitler got to be head of the German army.
What about all of his occult interests? You know.
Well, that's all planned.
Northern European race stuff, Hollow Earth, and all that.
That's all invented stuff that they worked out together. This Mein Kampf that he was supposed to write was hired to be done by a man in England, and he never wrote it at all. And as far as I could learn, and Babienko could learn, and then they went through with the Nazi works in World War II that you all know about. And now we have a breakdown in the communism. It isn't the old Bolshevik communism, and Catholicism is being put in Russia. And our work is going forward because they couldn't let Catholicism in without letting us in. And they're still holding down on things. But they're using Catholicism to gain control of the whole world. Over 50% of the world is communist today. I'll tell you something else that you might be interested in, and that is that when Woodrow Wilson was put in, the Catholics brought in enough Catholics from Europe with the understanding that they were to vote Democrat to throw the election for Woodrow Wilson.
It's a pity to have even to say that at this point in the history of the United States, in the history of the presidents, has not been other president. From the time of President Washington, that was the first president to be utilized by the Jesuits. If you were not aware of that, President Washington already was initiated by the Jesuits to bring about the first communication with the Vatican ever known in this country. From there on, President Reagan, throughout all this time, President Reagan has come to fulfill the greatest moment in the history of this conspiracy, because no other president has come as close as President Reagan with the Vatican, and even not even John F. Kennedy. What that means is they have done to President Kennedy, to President Reagan, what they were not able to do even through a Roman Catholic president. And nevertheless, I will say this, the religious belief of President Kennedy is nothing more, nothing else, than another expression of Catholicism. Perhaps I need to clear this. Roman Catholicism is not only the Roman Catholic system. Roman Catholicism is still, and it has been at work outside the Roman Catholic system. Well, that means there are many daughters of the Roman Catholic system outside the Roman Catholic system. And as there are many daughters, these daughters have children, and of course President Reagan fit within that picture. His relationship with the Vatican today brought about several things. One of them is the diplomatic relationship with the Vatican. Second, the preparation for the signature of a concordat between the Vatican and the United States. And if you want to know, this never took place overnight. President Reagan was prepared and initiated for the task that is performing today as President of the United States by the Jesuits of Rome in the time that he served as a star in a movie that was very well known and still being shown today, a very old movie, about the football team of Notre Dame.
Newt Rockne.
That's correct. This is the time that the first contact was made by the Jesuits with Reagan. Jesuits, under the stream of an induction, they were not directly to be involved. They only were the elements, the intellectual element that will prepare this. The case of Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln, the president, was killed by the Jesuits of Rome, but there was no Jesuit there involved directly. Nevertheless, was the Jesuit who prepared the plot against his life and prepared and trained those who were to kill him.
They arranged it.
Yes, yeah. It happened with President Kennedy, the same thing. Yeah. The assassination of Kennedy is another fact that can be proved of any time that was ordered by the Jesuits in order to get rid of a president that already was a shame to the Roman Catholic institution, being Roman Catholic. You have two different extremes. In Abraham Lincoln, you have that there was a man professing to be a Christian, solid Christian, and then there you have a man that professed to be a solid Catholic, but then put to shame his own institution when he was confronted about what he will do as a Roman Catholic president about the Constitution and about the interests of the Roman Catholic institution. When he placed the Constitution of the United States above the canon laws of the institution, he called for disaster.
Do you know anything about the assassination of President Kennedy and its connection with Catholicism?
Well, I wouldn't like to dwell too much on that. But I know one thing. They told President Kennedy that they were coming back after he refused to sign the parochial school bill. And they told him that he better sign it when they come back. And there was head Catholic officials there at the works. And the whole thing, I'm quite sure, was planned before they come back. They asked him to sign it. And he said, I'm told the Protestant people that I wouldn't sign a bill, a poker bill, while I'm in office this term. And I won't. I'm as good as my word. I won't go back on my word. And a short while after that, he was not a dead man. He was a vegetable. He wasn't killed. But his wife knew all about it and called the Greek boat fella and told him he wanted him, she told him that, he told her that he'd come and get him and take him over to his island. He was over on his island for some time, quite a while after that, when the whole family went over to the island, his family, Kennedy family, and they buried him out at sea. He was in the hospital on Greek island for quite a while.
What about the British royal family and the oligarchical families of northern Italy and some of these old families that have, actually ruled for years and years and years. Did they have any connection with the Roman Church today?
A lot of them did. A lot of them ruled under the Roman Church's authority. You take Henry in Germany. He defied the Pope for a little while, and the Pope made him come and humbled him to where he had to stand in the snow outside for days before the Pope would even talk to him.
But today you have a number of royal families still in existence in Europe.
Yes, they're permitted. It's just but the head royal family of Britain don't amount to a hill of beans. They're just figureheads, pencil work.
They don't have any power then.
They really don't have much power or any more power than you do.
What connection do you see then between Jesuitism and the Illuminati?
Well, the Illuminati is an outgrowth of papal plans to control the whole world. And it was through the Illuminati that the papacy got a great deal of its control of Great Britain and the United States. And they control more than what people realize.
This Schiller Institute, you've heard about the Schiller Institute or the, say, LaRouche's organization? They're the ones that organized and promoted this SDI. And also they're pretty extensive throughout the world. They've been putting a lot of people into office recently. And but their focus, you know, all of these different magazines have a different focus. Their focus is to unveil the machinery of the British ruling family and some of these other families, showing their involvement in international dope trade. And then they're into showing the dangers of the IMF and the banking fraud today.
All that don't amount to a hill of beans alongside of the giant octopus that controls behind the scenes. Mm. The whole thing is, you take in the United States, they let a lot of these things go because it works to their end. You take, if they demoralize the brains of the American youth, and they keep them undercover, and so that they can't get out to get into things like they would if they didn't, they used their brains and got up to the place where they should. Why, they can control situations.
So the drug trade is actually advantageous to the Roman Church then.
Absolutely, and Russia's pouring tons and tons and hundreds of tons of drugs in here for that purpose. Their final goal, they have goals just like anybody has goals, and they have the final goal of the takeover of this whole world and control of the whole world and everybody in it, and have them in slavery underneath them. Wherever the Catholics have gone, the first thing they do is get the cities in debt. The next thing is to get the county in debt. The next thing is to get the state in debt. The next thing is to get the government in debt. That's how they got control of Great Britain. That's how they got control of the United States. And when they get control of one of the state, got control of the United States, now they're trying to get control of every country in the whole world. And they've got the world underneath a bind at the present time, to where the economy is, where it works to a condition to where they take over. And they're working for a one-world government, a one-world takeover, and it's coming fast, faster than most people think.
How did the Jesuits change the system of Protestant education? You know, just what did they do, and how is the Protestant education now different than it was, say, prior to the Anti-Reformation?
Well, there's a lot of things that are different. There's no question about that. But they have worked up into the work of education and the educational field to where they help to control the education. And they try to control the education to where they are ruining the morality and the Protestant Jesuits that are being educated.
Why would they aim against morality? Isn't the Roman Catholic Church a Christian church, and wouldn't they want to teach morality?
They want to get rid of the other Protestants, and they'll do anything that is up to their ability to do away with it.
Let me tell you what the Knights of Columbus has done and performed a tremendous job in the United States in education, in public education. The authors of the chaotic situation of the public schools in the United States has been and are the Knights of Columbus in the United States.
The Protestant Church has never at any time used the theory of this here, what do you call it, in my mind, rapture theory. It's a pure Catholic theory, and when the Jesuits got into the churches as ministers and teachers, they started teaching the rapture theory to the Protestant churches, and now the Protestant churches are all wrapped up in the rapture theory and teaching the rapture theory.
What value is it to the Roman Catholics for Protestants to teach the rapture theory?
It does away with the sanctuary service in heaven and its work that's going on now according to the Holy Scriptures.
How does the Roman Catholic Church fit into this rapture theory?
Well, it came about as a result of Luther teaching that the Pope was the Antichrist, and to get away from the teaching of the Pope being the Antichrist, they decided to try to get some other theory to outdo it or overcome it. They first got one other theory that it was Antiochus Epiphanes that was the Antichrist, and none of the Protestants would accept that in those days, and so then they got the theory up of the rapture theory, and none of them would accept that. But when they got enough Jesuits in the Protestant Church to teach it as ministers and teachers, then they accepted it, and today they're teaching it.
What about the work of Alcazar and Rivera?
Now, these were two Jesuits that are starting already way back early, and before the 1600 already, Rivera and Alcazar were already commissioned to penetrate. Since the infiltration was very difficult in the days through the Reformation, they can spot an infiltrator very easily in those days because of the battle, the struggle was face to face with the Vatican. Then Roman Catholics and the Inquisitors, they have a hard time trying to infiltrate the Christian churches, even in Spain, where it was underground completely. They have a hard, difficult time, and there was a most very fearful thing to infiltrate, and nevertheless, they did it. They did infiltrate, and this is how they find many Christians worshiping the Lord in underground places. Now, through infiltration. But in these cases, they were not commissioned under the stream of an induction, as I was, under the stream of an induction. Rivera and Alcazar, they were to work, and then later Lacunza. There is more, but I will mention these three, the most important ones, in dealing with one special area, prophecy. They were assigned to deal especially with prophecy, with the purpose to do two things, at least, to cover up any prophecy related to the origin of the Antichrist, relate to the Antichrist, and relate to the papacy, relate to the Antichrist. And second, to cover up any idea that the Roman Catholic institution was never a Christian church, as I pointed out before. What that means is to make possible in Bible commentaries and church history that the Roman Catholic institution always will appear as a Christian church falling apostasy, and then need a renewal, yeah. And need a renewal. That was the idea that Rivera, Alcazar, and La Cruz tried to trace. Among other things, they tried to implement the idea that most of the prophecies of the Book of Revelations were already fulfilled by the time of Nero. Yeah. What that means is that don't worry about prophecies today, don't worry about the Antichrist, don't worry about a one world government, don't worry about nothing
Judaism.
Like that. Yes, that's correct. Walter Martin has been and confessed by him. As a matter of fact, I could mention that I have a debate already with Mr. Martin. I have already a debate with Mr. Gary Met, and I took them both by surprise. I took Mr. Gary Metz on radio by surprise. I not only persuade him, I force him to answer these accusations and these slanders. And then I took immediately Mr. Walter Martin and Anaheim. And both gentlemen, they were not looking really to meet with me. They were trying to avoid, if it were all possible, that confrontation that I did have with both. We have tapes of these confrontations and these debates. Mm. And then Mr. Walter Martin, he himself, even so that I knew his name and the list of very confident persons by the Jesuit order. What that means is that the Jesuit order will have a list made up in United States of people as well as in, as institutions that are worth trusting. And Mr. Walter Martin, I even mentioned to him in this confrontation with him that his name was listed in that list.
What did he say?
And he said to me, well, I don't know why my name is there. I said, you should know.
He should know.
Yes. I said, you should know. As a matter of fact, why Mr. Walter Martin, 25 years ago, he even wrote about the cult to Mary, a book about Mary, and 25 years after, he have a list, as a matter of fact, that I have with me, a list of cults where he lists the most dangerous cults, and all who in the list of his most dangerous cults are Christian Science, Jehovah's Witness, Mormons, starting with the Mormons. And suddenly, I thought, I was expecting that he will place at the top of the most dangerous cult, Roman Catholicism, but were the Mormons. Now, the Mormons become the victim of Roman Catholicism not only, but become the victim of Mr. Walter Martin, because even the Mormons are the product of Roman Catholicism.
The pressure for Sunday in the future is an issue. Is that a product of the Jesuits, or what do you know about that?
Well, what I know is this, that even the Seventh-day Adventist denomination has been placed under the greatest setup and a real setup of all the history of the denomination. And the proof and evidence is that now the leadership is already in a position where they themselves cannot play the role of a Frankenstein no longer, because they're being unveiled, they're being discovered, and their intents and their true intents, and cases where already most of them has been already trained, prepared by Jesuits to be where they are.
So, will this Sunday issue seems to be on the president's desk to be signed? The moral majority is pushing for it. The Lawyers Day Alliance has pushed for it from its inception. That was one of the reasons it was created.
Yes.
So in other words, you think that the for example, the Adventist leadership are going to fold up?
No, that is not true.
No.
In the context, the how the denomination has been set up and their keeping of the Sabbath is this. The Roman Catholic institution already, and this is why you have Viacocchi and some other elements within the denomination, they already has been even honored, condecorated by the Vatican concerning their work. And actually, the Roman Catholic institution is preparing the greatest surprise of them all, because it's not going to be even Sunday that they are going to be after. It's going to be Saturday, and you will see why. The reason of this is when already Catholicism already came about with the idea during the Vatican Council II that a Roman Catholic Mass that was only to be performed on Sundays as to be the only valid mass for Roman Catholic. Even if they go any other day, Saturday, Friday, there was no valid a mass for their obligations. Now, during the Vatican Council, the second session, suddenly the whole picture changed, and you know what for. The whole picture changed and said, now Saturday Mass is considered to be valid Mass as Sunday Mass. Well, that means not only that, more than that, Saturday Mass can replace Sunday Mass.
But it's the Protestants,
yes,
not the Jesuits that appear to be pushing for the Sunday, for national Sunday law.
Yes, actually, this is to trigger a reaction to really make use for a cover-up. The issue here is not even Saturday, is not even Sunday. The issue here, whether it's Saturday or Sunday, the issue here is the person of the Antichrist. You see, in matters of days, right now, the conflict is being utilized, the struggle between Saturday and Sunday is being utilized more for the benefit of Roman Catholicism than even for the benefit of the Christian Church. And that is how it has been exploited, to the point that already the Vatican approved, listen to this, approved the publication officially of Viacocchi, see, and dealing with from his book called From Saturday to Sunday. Now, if the Vatican go as far as approving a publication as such, what do you think that is happening? Do you see the point here?
Yeah.
If the Vatican go as far, telling an official, a member of the denominational body of the Seventh-day Adventist, I am the author of this book, I'm telling you that you have changed Saturday to Sunday, that you, as a Roman Catholic, you were the one that changed it. I mean, openly saying that there you did this. And the Cardinal Seren comes and say, oh yes, we agree, we did this, we agree. Now, what are they trying to gain by doing this, by accepting this? What they are trying to gain? They are trying to gain the sympathy, they are trying to gain the life, and they're trying to gain the entire denomination as they have gained the Pentecostal, as they have gained the Protestants through different other issues. Nevertheless, they touch every other issue except the real issue. Through any other issues, like the tongues business, the charismatic gift, you see, they are dealing with their things where they nobody can see what is behind. In other words, they cannot openly see any evil because you will see the Vatican as a good in a good position, a renewal position, say, yes, we recognize that we did wrong, we changed from Saturday to Sunday, and we admit this, and we're going to do something about it. The Vatican Council did it. You see, we are going to incorporate now officially the Mass on the day of Sabbath. You see?
Because the Bible's clear.
Oh, yes. When they go that far, you can see one thing for sure. Now, there is, in this issue, in my own personal belief of the Scripture, you do not see that the issue in prophecy is one day or the other. The issue in prophecy is more than a day. Is more than a day. The issue in prophecy is who and where is the Antichrist now. Once that the person perceives the reality and the manifestation of this prophecy, they'll know the rest according to the Scripture. But when a person is blind to the reality of who the Pope is, and the Pope is granting every favor to every other denomination, they'll believe that the Pope is not such a bad guy at all, after all.
The whole thing is that they don't care what happens to people.
Or who wins, as long as they come out.
As long as they're out on top. Yeah. And they see to it that they're on top or it don't begin. Or they put an end to it. Now, they have in a short while past said that there's too many of these proselyting people from South America in the Catholic Church. And there's too many people leaving the Catholic Church, and we've got to do something to stop it. And we're going to do something to stop it. And they've worked and told their priests to that extent. And that comes straight from the Vatican. Now, who is the proselyters? The main proselyters of Seventh-day Adventists, every week there's 10 to 11 and 12 churches being raised up. There are over 100 churches out of Catholicism in South America. The same thing in the countries above that. And they said, we've got a plan on doing something about this, and we're going to do it.
There's more opposition for it in the church than out of the church.
Well,
I'm wondering if there's a certain amount of activity or infiltration in the church that would try to hold these things down from within.
Well, there could be infiltration in the church without any questions. But you can't say there is or there isn't until you know what you're talking about. They're wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And they're maybe a little wiser in some respects than what they were here a few years ago, in the fact that they don't let things out to stir up indignation and get some people started. But there always is some, somewhere, somehow.
Gathering information.
Gathering information. There isn't a time when that won't happen.
If you want to do some homework throughout the news media, you will find something. Not only throughout the news media, but you will find something very interesting even throughout film industry. There are a lot of movies has come, and a lot of articles has been write up, and a lot of television shows has come out, and even movies and TV, and through radio, a lot of talk show has come out dealing with the very issues that I have dealt in these four parts of my testimony. They did not this before. Before 1979, over all these issues, everybody was quiet. Every other reporter will never inquire about celibates and the problems of celibates, about lesbian, about gays within the clergy, about the mafia and the relationship of the bishops and the cardinals with the mafia and the clergy, about the banks, international bank situation with the Vatican bank. Nothing of this was ever dealt with except when these testimonies went out. Then the news media start dealing, the film industry start dealing with priests that were unfaithful priests, cardinals that were unfaithful cardinals, bishops that were unfaithful bishops. As a matter of fact, even Jesuits within the Jesuit order were sent out immediately to answer to these very issues, to answer in their way. What that means is they went saying from every direction, yes, we recognize there are priests involved with the mafia, there are even bishops. We recognize there are priests that they have broken their celibates and they have committed a fornication and they're still committing fornication. We recognize it. But you see, the church is another matter. The idea always was to tell the Catholic people, tell the Christian world, yes, these things happen, but this is isolated. This is one priest, a bishop, a cardinal, someone that was unfaithful. But this is not the religion. This is not the system. This is not our belief. This is not our life. This is not our conduct. That is what they pretend to do. You have among even present Jesuits, Hans Kahn, the German Jesuits, and then you have Malachi Martin. These men under dispensation, what that means, granting them the authority and the power by the Vatican and the Jesuit general to go out and speak against the Pope, speak against the liturgy, speak against the clergy, and they will not suffer excommunion. You see that they can go now trying to deal with these very issues, trying to justify that regardless of all this commotion, of all this immorality, of all this corruption, of all these crimes, This is different from the mother, from the system. These are individuals within the clergy, but not the system. And of course, the system is the one that created them all.
Has there been a certain promotion to create in the United States a special way of looking at Roman Catholicism?
Oh, yes. Yes,
you some mean type of propaganda special for this
yes,
country?
Yes, definitely. This is why they has been so successful here in the United States, being a country of a Protestant inheritance with a Christian beginning, right in the 1620, when the pilgrims arrived to the northeast coast of this country. And suddenly, today, is making a concordat between the Vatican and the United States. Now, what that means, this is the greatest treason ever known to the very founders of this country. I mean, the most direct treason and betrayal that have taken place in this country has taken place, and the fact that now this government is looking for fellowship, for relationship with the very criminals that caused the greatest massacre in Europe, by which massacre and through which persecution the pilgrims arrived to the northeast coast of the United States.
We were told that the United States would repudiate every principle of the Constitution, and I'm sure that that is not too far in the distant future. You know, an integral part of the papal policy was an organization called the Inquisition during the Middle Ages. It began in the 12th century under Innocent III, which was the most powerful of all the popes of that time period. The purpose of the Inquisition was to seek out heresy and stop it. But it used some very unorthodox methods. One of those methods was to force certain confessions out of Christians or others, and with those confessions, use them to form public opinion, to raise crusades, to destroy the primitive Christian church. Crusades went out that destroyed people by the millions. We'll not know how many until the judgment day. But the Inquisition, the Catholic Church said, well, yes, there was an Inquisition, yes, we destroyed people, but it was part of the barbarity of the times. Others did it too. But of course, she claims that she's changed today, and Protestants are believing her. But you know, the Inquisition still exists, and it's actively being carried out. Beneath many of her large churches today are instruments of torture. I want you to listen to the testimony of Dr. Rivera as he begins to share with us about the Inquisition today.
In your training and in your life as a Jesuit priest for many years, did you ever come to the point that you were required to destroy human life?
Definitely. It's part of the oath and induction of any Jesuit that come under the oath and induction. And perhaps you care to know that I have revealed a great deal of this in this booklet after Alberto came out, the first part of my testimony, yeah, dealing with my minor seminar and major seminar as we went through these questions. And now you have in double cross, it is a revealing at least a little part in these pages here. This is 12 and 13 at least. You see that is part of the oath and induction that I was taking as I swear to take the life not only of kings and princes and governors and mayors and senators and congressmen, but even my mother or father or brother or sister, whosoever, come to be between the interests of the Roman Catholic system and the interest that they pursued. What that means is, if a president of a nation is there to interfere with the interest of the Roman Catholic institution and their pursuit of power, they will be crushed. That they'll actually, we were granted, I was granted that authority, that power, to exercise that authority, that power. That when any individual, whether it is a child, whether it is a woman, whether it is an elder man, whether it is a boy, whether it is a girl, whether it's a king or a queen, regardless of who the person is, when that person, that city, that nation, this country opposed to the goals of the Roman Catholic Institute and interfere with, that already call for disaster.
What would you say has happened to the Inquisition? You know, right now we don't see inquisitional tribunals, but we know that the goal of the church is still the same, and the engine of the Inquisition was set up all over the world. What's happened to that particular department of the church?
It's still in force in one way or another. He said to this fellow, if you weren't a Catholic, what would you be? He says, the big Monsignor Segura said to him, said, if I wasn't a Catholic, I'd be a Seventh-day Adventist. And he says, Charlie, if I could get out of being a Catholic, I'd be a Seventh-day Adventist tomorrow.
Is that right?
And he said, Charlie, he says, I advise you, if you can, to be a Seventh-day Adventist and join them. And then just a short while after that, it was a time when in the spring they have Good Friday and they don't eat certain things and meat on certain days. And they were having to go way out in the morning early and leave to their work. And so they had a special concession of the Chinese cafeteria that he was in, or restaurant, that he would come down at 4 o'clock in the morning and fix their lunch and give them what they wanted to eat. And Charlie Hibbard says to him, said, why don't you order yourself up a good beefsteak like I do? You know there's nothing to that. He says, well, he said, I mind too, I will. And while he was ordering up the beefsteak, he says, I don't know, I feel funny about this. And he went ahead and they ate the beefsteak, and he had his half gone when three big dignitaries of the Catholic Church marched in to find him and tell him about some of the work he had to do. And when they left, Charlie Hibbard looked at him and he said to Charlie Hibbard, you don't know what this means to me. He says, I'll catch hell for this. And he says, I used to be the head official that did the punishment for the folks that weren't living up to what they're supposed to. And if you go back to the great big churches in New York, you'll find way down deep under in the basement, where the corners are cut off like corner cupboards would be. And I was the one that took the people that was sentenced and changed them in that corner, brought one brick and one trowel of mortar each day and their meal until there was one opening for one brick. And I put in the last brick and the last trowel of mortar. And behind there's many skeletons. It says, you don't know, Charlie, what this means to me. I was the chief executioner for that deal. And me to eat beefsteak like this, he said, I'll hear from this in a few days. He says that I'm from that tribunal back there. And said, you wait and see. In a few days, he got a notice that he was to appear before the tribunal in New York. And when they left on the train, he said, Charlie, if I live after this, said, if I live, I'll send you a card, greetings for your birthday. The card never came. I could tell you stories like this by the hours.
So the Inquisitional Tribunal is still active for Roman Catholic people?
It's still active, and it is for people that are not Roman Catholic, if they get a chance to, without too much publicity that would damage them, their work and their cause.
Now, in Mexico, they opened up the cloistered convents and turned some of them into museums, so tourists can see the torture implements that were used on the nuns. And I imagine that in backward countries like Mexico and Spain and some of these areas, this type of thing keeps going without interruption then.
It's still done in America to some extent, too, in the United States of America. Yes, and I've seen in some of the basements where they're building some of their churches where they're preparing to put some of those things in.
They actually have cells and things underneath.
They have cells underneath, way down, not only one story, but stories and stories below.
There is enough left of the old Inquisition. I will say there is a new Inquisition today, not even tomorrow, is at work today, in here, even in the United States, and has been always. There is no replacement of a new Inquisition replacing the old. No. What happened is that the old Inquisition, as the years went by, under the sponsorship and guidelines of the Jesuit General and the Jesuit Order, they has been changing their devices and their tools, and their methods. You see, what happened is the Inquisition is the same Inquisition. The Holy Office never closed the door since it was established in 1200. You see, it never closed the door. As a matter of fact, within the Vatican, this is an office that never closed the door day and night. Today have a different name. It happened that they have a different name today, as they have different devices and methods to bring people to trial. Today, the Inquisition is at work. As a matter of fact, you have a book here that is called Night Journey from Rome, that we came to publish. A Night Journey from Rome is one of the last converted Roman Catholic priests in the United States, an American priest that was converted to Christ and his gospel about 2 years ago and came with us to the reading of Alberto, the first part of my testimony. He was, Clark Butterfield is his name, a Californian priest. There is the book here, Night Journey from Rome. And here is the most revealing thing about the actual Inquisition in the United States. He was so much aware of the reality of that Inquisition that in his own will, he prevent even his own relatives, from bringing his body to the Roman Catholic parish the day that he was ready to depart to be with his Lord and Savior. And he almost prophesied in thy will, because exactly that was the intention. Immediately that he was killed and murdered by the Jesuits of Rome in Detroit, Michigan, through a Roman Catholic doctor, member of the Knights of Columbus. Then you can see the Inquisition is alive and well, with different devices, different methods, and a different name. Today they call the office for the preservation of the doctrine and the faith. We were trained in many different things, from chemistry to poisons to warfare of any kind. And of course, we were not to be involved in these things. Let me explain this. Jesuits under the stream of an induction, they were not directly to be involved. They only were the elements, the intellectual element that will prepare this. The case of Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln, the president, was killed by the Jesuit of Rome, but there was a Jesuit there involved directly. Nevertheless, was the Jesuit who prepared the plot against his life and prepared and trained those who were to kill him.
They arranged it.
Yes, it happened with President Kennedy, the same thing. Yeah. The assassination of Kennedy is another fact that can be proved of any time.
Does the idea of assassination, murder, persecution, and suffering bother you? It really shouldn't. I remember when a Roman Catholic priest stood in this studio and told me that they were watching me and that they were serious about any threat to what they wanted to do. I told him, go ahead, shoot. What difference does it make? As long as I'm alive, I'll present this truth. But if I die, then my troubles are over. Everyone that will be in heaven will have suffered for Christ. When we get there, our Master will have scars in his hands. And only if we suffer will we feel we have a perfect right to that place. In fact, in Revelation 12, verse 11, we read, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death." This message we have to give, we've got to give without worrying about consequences. It's a divine message of truth. It can't fail. We're fulfilling the prophecies of the closing events, and it's going to go through to completion. It's time for all of us Adventists to wake up, give up the things of this world, and go forward and give this message. Now, I want you to listen very carefully as Dr. Rivera and Dr. Dukes share these thoughts with you.
The Lord is still in control. The Catholics are going to do what they're going to do. And there's nothing we can do about it, only just go out and do what we can to warn other people and get them into the right channel.
The future of Catholicism, according to the prophecy in chapter 17 of the book of Revelation, is what even the Holy Spirit used to convict me to leave at once a Roman Catholic system. That means there was no hope. I became a Christian within the Roman Catholic institution, and I want to stay within as many there to help the others. And there, from 17 to 18, God revealed to me there was no hope within the institution.
Why haven't they removed the Adventist Church thus far, then?
Because the good Lord has had a hand in things, otherwise it would have been done, and that's positive in my way of thinking. Mm-hmm. But they have plans for the Adventist Church now, and they have plans on fixing it so they can't buy our cell.
The best advice is based for Roman Catholic is to come out of her. That is God's decrees. Come out of her, my people. For Christians is what the book of Ephesians chapter 5 relate. He said clearly, do not have fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness.
What fellowship?
Rebuke then. That is the position of a Christian, and that is called by the Holy Spirit. I will say these are the two most urgent message to be communicated to the Roman Catholics, to come out of her, to the Christian, keep out of her, keep out of their fellowship. There is no fellowship, the light with darkness.
The seventh day is the Sabbath, and that God still reigns, and no matter what happens, no matter what the Catholic Church does, no matter what the Jesuits does or what their plans are, God's behind the scenes and he's with us. We have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear.
Do you believe there is Christians among the Roman Catholics? There are any Christians? And the person says, yes, there are Christians. Oh, I know. My own mother, my own father, you'll see. They don't believe in all these things. They just go there to witness about Christ. But they are truly Christians. You see the point here. They will say, she was not a Christian church, she's not a Christian church, she will not be, but they come and tell you there are Christians within the Roman Catholic institution. That is impossible. A person when is convicted under the Holy Spirit, being a Roman Catholic, the first thing that the person felt and know that she or he must do is to leave Roman Catholicism. Because Roman Catholicism leave first from then, and then they leave after. You see, even a person that leave Roman Catholicism without being a Christian, Roman Catholicism is still with the person. What that means is they can leave the physical system, but Roman Catholicism is still with the person. Only Christ can eradicate from the root Roman Catholicism from the heart of a person.
It's amazing to hear these messages coming from someone who's not even a Seventh-day Adventist. But we're told that the majority of those that will give this message will come out of the Catholic and the Protestant churches during the loud cry in the latter rain. In fact, very, very few that now profess the truth will press their way through the narrow way that leads to life eternal and be saved at last. Brethren, I don't want any of you to be lost. The message we have is just too important right now. There are those that are arising in our church today which are undermining our historical position on prophecy and trying to get our people to join in a more ecumenical posture with the churches of this world. While on the other side, on the conservative side of things, there are those who are rising up and trying to take our historical prophecies and reapply them into the future, weakening the historical message of Adventism. It's time for Adventists everywhere to begin to restudy out the messages that made us the people that we are, and to present those messages with power before the world, under the power of the Holy Spirit. Friends, it's time that the Sabbath be presented to the world more fully. We have gathered here in our studio pictures and film from every corner of the globe showing that the Sabbath was kept in every country right down through the centuries. We've been able to show that in the early centuries that the Sabbath was kept by all the Christian churches but Rome and Alexandria. This message needs to go out, and we need your help, and we need your prayers. We can't do it alone. We need all Adventists everywhere to help us. Would you please have prayer with me as we close? Dear Lord in heaven, now as we face the last years in the great drama, we pray that you will move upon the hearts of Adventists everywhere to raise up workers to finish this work. Move upon the hearts of those who see this program to set aside this world and prepare for the coming of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.